Let me tell you a little bit about the remarkable career of Professor Chetty. Raj immigrated from India as a child. He has had a meteoric rise in the field of economics. At the young age of 23, Raj earned his PhD from Harvard and became Dr. Chetty. Little known fact, I received my minor in economics from Mankato State University in Minnesota, commonly known as the Harvard of the Midwest. We have that in common, Dr. Chetty. Just so you know, if you're ever looking for an economics minor lecture, right here. So Professor Chetty spent a few years as an assistant professor at Cal Berkeley before being lured back to the snow and cold by Harvard to become one of the youngest ever tenured professors at age 29. He returned in 2015 to join the faculty at Stanford. Along the way, he was awarded the MacArthur Genius Award in 2012 and recognition by the New York Times, The Economist, and many others as one of the most influential economists in the world. I can't even pronounce it. Economics, I've got a minor there, that explains it. So he advises Congress, both sides of the aisle, and policymakers around the country and the world. One topic that Professor Chetty will discuss is his recent research about America's lost Einsteins. These are the young people who could be, who would be, our future inventors and creators if they had the right conditions and supports as they grow up. I want to introduce to you a found Einstein. This is Deka. She grew up in City Heights, where our office is located, in one of the more challenged neighborhoods in our region. She grew up she's the immigrant daughter of a single mother, and Deka is often the caregiver for her four younger siblings. Last summer, she participated in the Workforce Partnerships Life Sciences Summer Institute, which has been around now since about 2005, to get young adults into these amazing internships at the Salk Institute, Scripps Ocean of Institute of Oceanography, and a number of others up in the innovation sector. Deka says that her LSSI internship helped her select science as her career, but the experience also enabled her to see herself as welcome and capable in the world of inventors and scientists, probably the most invaluable takeaway of all. Just imagine all of the Dekas in our region whose talent we can and must unleash. So and now, on behalf of National University and the Workforce Partnership, please join me in welcoming Dr. Raj Chetty.
Thanks so much for the very warm introduction. There's really nothing more inspiring as an academic than hearing about how your work has been relevant to people and how it's influenced their own practice. And so I tremendously appreciate your sharing that. And thanks so much to the Workforce Partnership and National University for hosting this event. I think it's all of you in this room who can really make a difference in using the research and data that we and many others are trying to produce. So I thank you all for your interest and for being here today. So I want to start off by talking about the American dream, which is a complicated, multifaceted concept that means different things to different people. But let's distill it to a way that people have thought about it traditionally, a simple statistic that we can measure in the data, which is what fraction of children go on to earn more than their parents did at a comparable age. So often the American dream is conceptualized as kids, if they work hard enough, have chances of climbing the income ladder and perhaps having a higher standard of living than their parents achieved. And so in a recent paper with my colleagues, we started out by asking just a very simple question: is the American dream alive and well? Do kids really have a chance of doing better than their parents today as they did in the past? And that actually turns out to be quite a challenging question to answer from a data perspective. But we were able to put together a bunch of different information to be able to construct this chart here, which shows you the fraction of kids who earn more than their parents, comparing their incomes roughly at age 30 to how much their parents earned when they were age 30, adjusting for inflation, based on the year in which the child is born. And so what you can see here is that for kids born in the 1940s and 1950s, it was a virtual guarantee that you were going to achieve the American dream of doing better than your parents. 92% of kids born in 1940 went on to earn more than their parents did. If you look at how this has evolved, you see a very stark pattern that we've called the fading American dream. If you look at kids who are turning 30 today, born in the 1980s, it's now become essentially a coin flip. as to whether you will do better than your parents, a 50-50 shot of whether you're going to do better than your parents in terms of earnings. Now, of course, earnings are not everything. They're one thing that we can measure in the data. But my sense is that this trend really captures a lot of the frustration that people around the country are expressing. It's very hard to get ahead. And in particular, if you look at certain demographic groups, for example, men in the industrial Midwest, you see even steeper declines, very consistent with the type of issues you heard about in the election, for instance, where people were expressing the most frustration. And so motivated by this trend, the focus of my research group, what we're calling the Equality of Opportunity Project, is to answer a basic question. How can we restore the American dream? What drew my parents to this country, what drew a lot of people around the United States, you know, what I think is really the core of the fabric of America. So our angle on that is to use big data to study this issue. And so you hear a lot about big data nowadays in the private sector, companies like Google and Amazon using large data sets and modern technology to improve the products that they offer. Our vision is that we can analogously use big data to tackle important social and economic questions, in particular, thinking about issues of inequality and opportunity. So the particular data I'm going to talk about today, and I know a lot of you have interest in data issues in your own practice, what the data I'm going to talk about, coming mainly from government sources, things like Social Security records, tax records, census data, will allow us to look at people over time, look at people's conditions from childhood to adulthood, and that's going to allow us to analyze a range of interventions over the life course. As you're thinking about economic opportunity, developing from the conditions in which kids are born to what's going on when they're entering the labor market to workforce issues and so on. The starting point for a lot of our work is the fact that there are sharp differences in children's chances of climbing the income ladder across areas within America. So that national chart that I started out with actually, you know, masks the fact that there's a lot of variation across different parts of the United States. And so to show you that, I'm going to turn to this map here, where we take data on all kids who grew up in the early 1980s in the US, about 10 million kids, and we classify them into 740 different metro and rural areas based on where they grew up, and ask, what are your odds of climbing the income ladder? And we measure that in a simple way here. Let's take the set of kids who start out in the bottom fifth of the income distribution and ask what fraction of them reach the top fifth of the income distribution. So the classic Horatio Alger version of the American dream, what fraction of kids climb from the bottom to the top? And so the way the map is colored is that darker green colors represent areas with higher levels of upward mobility, and redder colors represent areas with lower levels of upward mobility. Let me start by just drawing your attention to the scale in the lower right first. So you can see that in the darkest green colors, you see rates of upward mobility that exceed 16.8%. Now, is that a large number? You know, sometimes people react by saying 16.8% of kids reach the top starting from the bottom. That doesn't seem all that high, right? Well, you have to remember, of course, that no matter what you do, you can't have more than 20% of people in the top 20%, right? And so the maximum value that number can reach is 20%. To put it differently, if your parents played no role at all in determining your outcomes, we'd expect 1/5 of kids to start from the bottom quintile and reach the top quintile, and 1/5 of kids from all the other quintiles to reach the top quintile. And so relative to that max of 20% of sort of perfect mobility where your parents have no role at all, 16.8% is quite a high number. In fact, it's a higher rate of upward mobility than any country, for example, Scandinavian countries, which are thought to have some of the highest levels of social mobility in the world. But at the other end of the spectrum, if you look at the darkest red colors, look at places like Atlanta and Charlotte or Cleveland, for example, you have rates of upward mobility below 5%, lower than any country for which we currently have data. And so the answer to the question, is the US a land of opportunity? It actually doesn't have a single answer. It depends tremendously upon where you're growing up. It's very heterogeneous. Now, I'm going to show you a bunch of data for California and San Diego in particular. You can see San Diego looks pretty good at 10.4%. It's well above the national average of about 7.5%. It's not the highest, but it's quite high. However, one important thing I want to note, and you should keep in mind as we talk through these issues, is that this data is for kids who grew up in the 1980s and 1990s. Why is that? Because if you want to measure economic mobility, the kids actually have to be old enough that you can measure their earnings at a, you know, and you can't do that when kids are 20 because many of them are still in college and so forth. So we're waiting till kids are around 30 years old to measure their earnings, which is why you have to go back to kids born in the 1980s to be able to construct these measures. Why is that important in the context of a place like San Diego? This is obviously a city that's changing tremendously. Rates of segregation are rising. Real estate prices have gone up a lot and so forth. And so there is no guarantee that the high levels of economic mobility we saw in the past here will necessarily continue to prevail. And I'll come back to that issue going forward. I think that's a central issue you should all be thinking about. Now, in this broad national map, your eye naturally gravitates to regional variation. For instance, you see much lower levels of upward mobility in the southeast than in the center of the country and so forth. But as you zoom in further, you see that there's quite a bit of variation even within local areas. So in our ongoing work, we're going to finer and finer geographies. This gives you an example of that, where we're now looking at the data at a county level in the Bay Area. And you can see that even within the Bay Area, which in general has quite high rates of upward mobility, was in a green color on the map that I showed you before, if you break that up by county and compute the same statistic, what fraction of kids who start out in low-income families in each of these counties reach the top fifth of the national income distribution, you see there's a lot of variation. So San Francisco, for kids who were growing up there in the 1980s, see remarkably high rates of upward mobility of 18.5%, very close to that 20% max I was talking about. In contrast, if you go across the Bay Bridge to Oakland, that number falls by nearly a factor of 2 to 11%. And so even within very narrow areas, as we zoom in further and further, you'd see this within San Diego as well, you're going to find really sharp differences in rates of upward mobility across districts, across counties, and so forth. And so naturally, the question of interest for us as academics and for policymakers is, why does upward mobility vary so much across areas? And what can we ultimately do to increase upward mobility in the redder colored areas on the maps that I've been showing you? So the first point I want to make on that question is that most of the variation in upward mobility that I've been showing you is caused by differences in childhood environment. So there are two key points in that statement. The first is the word caused. So usually in social science, it's very difficult to figure out the difference between correlation and causation. For instance, in the maps that I've been showing you, it could be that some places have higher rates of upward mobility simply because they have a different set of people than other places. Obviously, the set of people living in the Bay Area, for example, are very different from the set of people living in Atlanta. So maybe it's not something about the Bay Area in particular that's producing high upward mobility. Maybe it's just about different people living in different places. So what I'm going to show you is, in fact, that's not the case. It actually seems like the causal effect of growing up in different places, environment really matters in producing these different outcomes. And the second key point is that it's about childhood environment. A lot of the differences that we're seeing across these areas are not just due to differences in the types of jobs that are available or the labor market, other things that you'd normally think of that economists would gravitate toward, but actually about conditions in childhood. And this is exactly why I'm very happy to hear you're taking an expanded view of workforce development, that it's not just about that endpoint, but thinking about the full pipeline of opportunity in a sense. So I want to show you how we reach those important conclusions. Without going into the statistical details of the study, where we use information on 7 million families who move across areas, I'm going to show you how we reach these conclusions with a simple example. Okay? So let's say we take a set of families that start out in Oakland, and suppose, just to pick a round number, if you grow up from birth in Oakland, you earn on average, let's say, $30,000 when we measure your earnings at age 30 in tax records, for example. Now, let's take a set of families that move from Oakland to San Francisco, which, as we saw on the map that I showed you, seems to have better outcomes for low-income kids. So again, to pick a round number, let's say if you grow up in a low-income family from birth in San Francisco, you earn $40,000 on average when you're 30 years old. So now what I want to do is think about a set of families who move from Oakland to San Francisco with kids of different ages. starting with families who move when their child is exactly 9 years old, which happens to be the earliest age that we're able to look at in currently available data. So what that dot there is showing you is that when we look at these kids who make this move when they're exactly nine and track them forward 21 years and measure their earnings when they are 30, we see that they end up about halfway between the kids who grew up in Oakland from birth and the kids who grew up in San Francisco from birth. That is, they're earning about $35,000 on average. Okay, so that's for the children who move when they're exactly nine. Now let's repeat that analysis for kids who move when they're 10, 11, 12, 13, and so on. You see is a very clear pattern. The later you make that move from Oakland to San Francisco, the less of a gain you get. If you move after you're in your early 20s, the relationship is completely flat. So what do you see from this chart? I think there are three key takeaways. The first is that where you grow up really seems to matter. That is, environment really matters. The people who live in Oakland are different from the people who live in San Francisco, but apparently if you take a given child and move that child from Oakland to San Francisco, you see really different outcomes for that child. So I see that as a really encouraging result because it shows that you can meaningfully affect kids' chances of moving up the income ladder. This is not like some immutable thing where you're destined to have low levels of opportunity in some places. You can actually change people's outcomes in a really profound way. Second, you see that what really seems to be important is childhood environment rather than environment in adulthood. If you move as a young adult, it doesn't really do a whole lot for you in terms of your economic outcomes. It's all about moving as a kid. And the third thing you see is that every extra year of exposure to a better environment is associated with better outcomes. So if you move at age 10 instead of 11, you do better. If you move to a better place when you're 13 instead of 14, you do better. Every extra year, it kind of adds up over time, such that if you got there when you were born to one of those greener colored areas on the map, you're going to do much better in adulthood. Now, why is that last point important from a policy perspective? As you all know, there's a lot of discussion nowadays of the importance of early childhood intervention. So our view is that early childhood intervention, for example, in improving the quality of preschools can be incredibly valuable. But what these data show you is that it's not like everything sort of stops after preschool and then you should sort of give up if you haven't fixed things by then. If you improve environment, even when kids are 10 or 15, it continues to have significant effects. And so we should really be thinking about the pipeline of opportunity as extending throughout childhood into the college going years. And so I'll talk about various pieces that contribute to what that, how you create that strong pipeline during childhood. Okay, and so that is naturally the next question. So we've established that some places seem to produce better outcomes than others. So naturally the next thing you want to know is, okay, you've shown me some childhood environments generate better outcomes than others. What is it? What is the recipe for success that leads to better outcomes in some of these places relative to others? Now, that is an incredibly challenging question to answer. It's one that we and many others are working on at the moment. What I can show you for the time being is analysis that we've done to characterize the areas that tend to have high levels of upward mobility. So we look at lots of different factors that sociologists and economists have talked about over the years. We try to come up with a picture of what the green colored areas on the map look like. What are these places that have high levels of upward mobility? What are some of their common characteristics? And we've identified five common characteristics of places that have high levels of upward mobility, starting with residential segregation. We find that places that are less segregated by race and by income tend to have higher levels of upward mobility. Now, there are many ways in which you can measure residential segregation from a statistical point of view, but it turns out that the exact measure that you use of residential segregation actually doesn't matter that much because the patterns are so stark here that you can just see them visually. So let me give you a couple of examples. So this map here depicts racial segregation in Atlanta. The way it's constructed is that each person in Atlanta using census data is represented by a dot, and the dots are colored so that whites are blue, blacks are green, Asians are red, and Hispanics are orange. And you can see it's totally obvious Atlanta is an incredibly segregated city. The blue dots are in a completely separate part of the city from the green dots. Whites and blacks live in completely different parts of the city. It doesn't matter what statistical measure you use, it's clear that this is a very segregated environment. And corresponding to that, Atlanta and cities that look like this in terms of residential structure tend to have the lowest levels of upward mobility in the country. Now, if in contrast you look at Sacramento, which actually has the same minority share as Atlanta, the same fraction of blacks and Hispanics as Atlanta, you can see here the colors are much more interspersed than what we saw in Atlanta. There's more integration. They're not perfectly interspersed, but they're more interspersed than they were in Atlanta. And corresponding to that, Sacramento and cities that look like this tend to have significantly higher levels of upward mobility. Now, you might be wondering, where does San Diego fall in this picture? So this is what the map looks like in San Diego. So San Diego, as we talked about earlier, has relatively high levels of upward mobility compared to much of the rest of the country. However, it is, and it's increasingly becoming, a quite segregated city by race. Not as segregated as Atlanta, but it's clear that, you know, Hispanics, whites, Asians are living in quite different parts of the city. And I think that's something that's very relevant as you think about affordable housing and other related issues going forward and think about how that interacts with economic opportunity. So something I would keep an eye on in San Diego. So that's one key factor, segregation. So let me talk a little bit more quickly about other key factors that we've identified. So the second strong pattern is that places with less income inequality, that is a larger middle class, tend to have higher levels of upward mobility. Cities where there are more people between the 25th and 75th percentile of the national income distribution tend to have more kids climbing the income ladder across generations. Why is that important? As you all know, we're living in an era of rising income inequality in the United States. And so there's quite a bit of debate about whether we should worry about that or not. You know, depends somewhat on your political views, how concerned you are about inequality and so forth. But insofar as there's a link between inequality and your chances of climbing the income ladder and achieving the American dream, I think that paints a different picture on why we might be concerned about the rise in income inequality. If it erodes kids' chances of achieving economic opportunity, if it erodes equality of opportunity in the United States, I think there are a lot more people universally sort of believe in the idea of equality of opportunity. And so that, I think, is again, in an area like San Diego with expanding inequality, something to keep in mind. The third and fourth strong patterns that we find come more from sociology than economics. We find a very strong correlation between proxies for the stability of family structure in an area and rates of upward mobility. This is actually the single strongest correlation you find in the data. Areas with more two-parent families tend to have higher levels of upward mobility. Now, in interpreting that correlation, there's an important nuance there, which is that the simple thing that might come to your mind, this is the direct effect of kids growing up in two-parent households rather than single-parent households, and maybe that directly benefits the kids and helps them do better in the long run. That is not by itself the key mechanism, and the way we know that is if we look at the subset of kids whose own parents are married and compare kids who grow up in an area with a lot of single parents versus areas with very few single parents, we continue to find a very strong correlation. That is to say, even if your own parents are married, but you grow up in an area that has a lot of single parents, you are less likely to climb the income ladder. So what that shows you is that it's not literally about whether your own parents are married or not, not literally about whether you're growing up in a two-parent household. It's again picking up something broader about the community that seems relevant in terms of perhaps family stability or other related factors. A fourth factor that is somewhat related to that is the idea of social capital. This concept was popularized in a well-known book by Bob Putnam at Harvard called Bowling Alone, which some of you might know. The idea of social capital, I think of the old adage that it takes a village to raise a child as capturing what that's about. Will somebody else help you out even if you're not doing well? Salt Lake City with the Mormon Church is thought to be a classic example of a place with a lot of social capital. Corresponding to that, Salt Lake City has one of the highest levels of mobility in our data, and more generally, places with a lot of social capital tend to have high levels of upward mobility. And then the fifth, relevant to the audience here, places like National University, is areas that have higher quality education provide access to good education for kids from low-income families, perhaps not surprisingly, but you know, importantly from a policy perspective, tend to have high levels of upward mobility. So these broad factors give you a sense of what the drivers might be, where we should be looking at a national level to increase upward mobility. What I want to do now is pivot towards going from this broader national analysis to asking how can we use this type of data to improve opportunity in specific areas like San Diego. And your introduction, President Andrews, the Precision Institute, I did not use this terminology, just to match the Precision Institute, but it turns out to fit quite well. The way we're thinking about this is that economics traditionally takes kind of a broad brush approach to answering questions like how you tackle inequality and improve opportunity. But our view is that with modern data, you can take an approach that's more precise, more along the lines of precision medicine or personalized medicine that can be much more effective. So let me give you an example of how we're coming at this. So often, question you'll get when you're working in this space is, do you think charter schools are good or bad? When you really look at the data, you figure out relatively quickly that that question does not have a single answer. There are some situations, depending upon the quality of public schools that are available, where charter schools might actually improve outcomes quite a bit. There are certain charter schools that are pretty effective. There are other situations where charter schools actually make things quite a bit worse. And so I think the idea that you can have sort of one size fits all answers to complex policy questions is really not right. But the reason we've gravitated towards that type of approach in policymaking in the past is we simply have not had the information or the data to be able to offer diagnoses that are sort of customized to the area in question or to the particular problems that a community faces. And so what I want to talk about in the rest of this lecture is how we can use big data to provide targeted diagnoses and advice and potentially work with many of you here in San Diego to use that type of data to develop interventions that will ultimately improve many people's lives. So in analogy with medicine, start out in the first phase with diagnosis, and I think about this in three dimensions. First, where are the places in the greatest need of improvement? What specific neighborhoods within a city, for example? Second, what types of policy approaches are likely to be effective? Should we be thinking about certain types of investments in a community? Should we be helping people perhaps move to other areas of higher opportunity? What are the types of policy approaches that should be on the table? And then third, at what time points in a child's life should we be intervening? Is it about, are things sort of going wrong right at birth? Is it about prenatal care? Is it about early childhood environment? Is it about access to higher education? I think there are a set of different interventions from a time point perspective where diagnosis along that line can be very helpful. So I'll show you examples of how we can provide these types of diagnoses with modern data. But then the next phase really comes to all of you thinking about how to develop treatments. One of the things I've learned as an academic is just, sort of sitting in the ivory tower and trying to formulate solutions really is never very effective because you don't have a good feel for what the problems actually are and what might actually work on the ground. And so the way we're approaching this, and I'll talk about some examples of early partnerships and others we're hoping to develop going forward, is to work with local stakeholders on the design of interventions that can really make a difference. And then, as you'll see, I think we can use the same data that we started out with for the diagnosis to evaluate the impacts of those interventions and disseminate lessons more broadly, hopefully leading to scalable policies that lead to greater upward mobility across the United States. So let me now demonstrate this kind of template with a couple of examples how we're going about this more, more concretely. So let's start with the diagnosis. Thinking about the where dimension. So in a project we're working on with the Seattle Housing Authority, we are thinking about where interventions in Seattle can be most effective. And so the first step in that is to take the type of data that I was using before to show you the national and county level maps. What we've now done is geocoded the data so that we can look at the data census tract by census tract across the entire United States, and we started out focusing in Seattle in particular, which is why I'm showing you the data for Seattle here. And so what this is the same type of analysis I was showing you before, classify kids now into census tracts where they grew up. What's a census tract? It's like basically an amalgamation of blocks. The average census tract has about 4,000 people. There's 70,000 census tracts in America, so these are really fine geographies. So a particular part of San Diego would be broken up into many, many different census tracts. And so you can see we're showing that data here for Seattle, where, as I was saying earlier, there's lots of variation in kids' outcomes depending upon where we're growing up. So this is the same sort of statistic we started out with, taking the set of kids who grow up in low-income families in Seattle, families that are at the 25th percentile of the national income distribution, and asking, where did those kids end up in the earnings distribution in adulthood? Importantly, with these data, we can track you no matter where you are in the US. So if you grew up, you know, in a particular block in Seattle and you now live in Boston, we still see your earnings information. So that's critical when you're doing this type of analysis. And so what you can see, again, just look at the scale, there's an enormous amount of variation in kids' earnings outcomes depending upon where they grew up in Seattle. In the red colors here, kids are earning less than $20,000 a year and they're in their mid-30s on average. In the dark green colors, for example, on the east side of Seattle, on the other side of the lake, you have people earning more than $45,000 a year. And remember, this is taking a set of kids who start out in families at the 25th percentile. We're not just picking up the fact that Bellevue has higher income families than downtown Seattle. This is saying controlling for your parents' income, how different your outcomes look, and you see rates of upward mobility look quite different. Okay, so that suggests that you want to think about interventions that might help kids starting out in the south side of Seattle, starting out in the central district, and so forth. So how do you go about doing that? I think it's useful to think about two very different types of policy approaches. And basically revolves around, do you want to invest in people or do you want to invest in specific places? So let's think about each of these in turn. Let's start out with what you might call a choice-based approach, where you help people move potentially to better areas. So to show you how that works in Seattle, let me turn to this chart here, which illustrates why an approach of helping families move to opportunity might actually be very productive in a place like Seattle. So what this chart is doing is on the vertical axis, it's putting the data that I showed you in the map, which is the mean income of kids who grow up in low-income families based on the census tract in which they grew up. And on the horizontal axis, we're putting the median rent of apartments of housing in that area. Okay, so what's the logic of this? We're basically trying to look at the price of buying opportunity in Seattle. How much more expensive of a place do you have to live in order to sort of buy better opportunity for your kids, in order to have better outcomes for your kids? So you would think intuitively, you know, opportunity might cost something. Prices get bid up in places that have good schools, for example. And so it ends up costing low-income families money to achieve better outcomes for their kids. And in fact, you see somewhat of a correlation. There's an upward slope in this data consistent with that. But what's, I think, really striking is that if you look, for example, at a place like Del Ridge, which is a place where a lot of low-income families in Seattle currently live, in particular, a lot of families who are receiving Section 8 housing vouchers, that's one of the most common tracts where families with housing vouchers live in Seattle, look at these families, they could actually potentially make a move straight up on this chart to areas that we would think of as opportunity bargains, places that would be perfectly affordable to a family with housing vouchers, but would generate substantially better outcomes for their kids, where their kids would be earning, we estimate, 15% more if they grew up in a place like Normandy Park rather than Del Ridge. So why is that an opportunity bargain? Because it's not like you have to move to Bellevue, which would be incredibly expensive, in order to achieve that outcome. You can actually do that feasibly for a low-income family. And so that shows you that that's something concretely right now we might be able to do. And so in fact, we're currently partnering with the Seattle Housing Authority on a large pilot study where they are trying to figure out, and they're designing, we've designed a set of interventions to help their clients make exactly those types of choices. So the fundamental problem here is that in Seattle and in most other places in the United States, I suspect that would be true if we construct this type of data for San Diego as well, you see that most housing voucher recipients currently live in relatively low opportunity areas, even though they could afford to live in areas that would be higher opportunity for their kids. And that's extremely important because we spend about $45 billion a year in the US on affordable housing programs that are intended to create more economic opportunity, but our sense is that money is not being deployed in as effective a way as it could. And so in Seattle, what we're doing with the Housing Authority, there is essentially three sets of interventions. We're providing prospective tenants this type of information, just the simple fact, like, look, your kids could do better if you lived in Normandy Park than Delridge. Now, for families coming in to get a housing voucher, they may not be in a position where they can make that sort of move and so forth. So we have funds to provide a little bit of financial assistance on top of the voucher itself in order to facilitate such a move. Then on the landlord side, in a very tight housing market like Seattle, often landlords will say, you know, I don't want to deal with housing voucher recipients. There are all these inspections and other things, and I'm worried about not having the rent paid and damage to the apartment, things like that. So we have a set of initiatives for landlords where we simplify the inspection process, provide an insurance fund in case anything goes wrong, basically try to recruit landlords into the program, tell them that this can have great benefits for the community. And then a third piece is brokerage services, where you try to bring the landlords and tenants together. For higher income folks, there are of course lots of services in the market that help you find the apartment that you're looking for. At the low end of the market, because there's not that much money there, it's very hard to find such assistance. And so we provide that such assistance through this program. And our hope, basically the idea of this, is maybe we will, without really spending that much more money, just using the housing voucher money that's already been allotted by HUD to the Seattle Housing Authority, potentially be able to improve kids' outcomes and develop a model that could be scaled to many other places, including potentially San Diego. So that's one approach. Now, of course, that approach by itself is not a scalable solution to improving economic opportunity in America. What I think is desirable about it is that it's immediately actionable. It's something that we can do with currently available data that will affect kids' outcomes in the short run, proven in prior data. But at the end of the day, you can't possibly move everyone. And in a place like Atlanta, you know, you're not going to move everybody out of Atlanta to a different city. That just doesn't make sense. And so ultimately, you need to think in the longer run about place-based approaches. How can you invest in Atlanta? How can you invest in neighborhoods within San Diego that we will be able to identify that currently offer lower levels of opportunity? And so that can take a lot of different forms that we are currently studying with these types of data. It could take the form of investments in prenatal care. So think about home visitation programs, for example, like the Nurse Family Partnership. It can, of course, take the form of various interventions in K-12 schools, trying to improve, say, the quality of teachers, improving the programs that are offered, improving resources, and so forth. It can involve improving access to higher education in an area. It might involve other domains, like if there are interventions people have in the context of family stability, for example. So we can talk in more detail about each of these buckets, and I'm happy to address what people are interested in. Given this particular audience and where we are, I'm going to focus on college access issues. Not because I think that's the only important one and the other ones don't matter. It's just more in the interest of time. My view is basically in this pipeline of opportunity, all of these different pieces matter. And to illustrate how I think we can use data to improve what we're doing, I'm going to focus on the college access piece. Okay, so in thinking about college access, the first thing I'm going to do is start out by just thinking about how many low-income kids there are at different colleges in California. So in a recent study, using these types of data, we put out information for the first time on the income distribution of parents of students at every college in America, in particular colleges that have sort of a traditional student body enrolled between the ages of 18 and 22, typically. You know, in the past, it's been very difficult to know exactly how much access is being provided at different colleges because we haven't had this type of information. But by linking information from tax records to information from the Department of Education and so forth, you can construct these types of statistics. And everything I'm showing you here is now publicly available. You'd be able to download it from our Equality of Opportunity Project website or a New York Times tool that's been developed and so forth. And so I'm going to show you some examples to illustrate what's relevant here. Focusing on California area colleges, starting with my own institution, Stanford. And so what this chart shows you is just simply, you know, where are kids at Stanford coming from in terms of the incomes of their parents? And so you can see at Stanford, something like, 65, 70% of kids come from the top income quintile. and only about 2.3% of kids come from the bottom income quintile. So like many other elite private colleges, Stanford is very tilted to kids from high-income backgrounds. A particularly striking statistic is if you look at the fraction of kids at Stanford coming from families in the top 1%, that's 14.5% of kids. The top 1% threshold in this sample is an income of $650,000 a year. So more than roughly 15% of kids at Stanford come from families making more than $650,000 a year. I think that is striking. You know, another way that you can look at that is your odds of showing up at Stanford. I'm mentioning Stanford in particular. Same thing is true at, you know, Princeton, Harvard, et cetera, basically the same pattern. Your odds of being at those, what we call Ivy Plus institutions, are about 80 times higher if you happen to be born to a family in the top 1% relative to family at the median of the US income distribution. So access at American elite private colleges is extremely skewed to high-income kids. Now, that's not necessarily because purely of their own policies, right? It's the product of everything that's happening up to that point where, in order to have the credentials to get into such an institution, maybe you had to go to certain private schools or live in the right neighborhoods, et cetera. So I don't by any means want to assign blame to any one group of actors here, but this is a fact. The product of the system we have in the United States leads to an outcome like this at Stanford. Okay, so now that's just as a reference. Let's now think about the colleges that actually educate much larger numbers of kids and look at other comparisons. And so I'm going to zoom in on Southern California and San Diego area schools in particular. So here's Pepperdine, another private institution, where you see slightly fewer kids from the top income quintile, but it looks broadly relatively similar to Stanford, relatively few kids from below the median, the first and second quintiles. Now coming to UC San Diego, so the UCs, you would think traditionally, you might expect are really the engines of mobility for much of California, in fact, for much of the United States. UC San Diego, in fact, does have a significantly larger number of low and middle income kids than a place like Stanford. However, it is not by any means close to an equal distribution, 20% from each income quintile. It's still a quite significant overrepresentation for kids from high-income families. That's true at UCSD, that's true at UC Berkeley, that's true at Riverside, and so forth. Colleges that look much more equal in terms of where the students come from are places like the San Diego Community College District, where you see it looks like roughly 20% are coming from each quintile of the income distribution. And so it really, in terms of providing access to low-income kids, it's places like the San Diego Community Colleges that are doing sort of a lot of work in educating kids from lower-income families. Okay, so in thinking about social mobility and economic opportunity, this is one half of the picture. This is, think of it as like the inputs, who is showing up at institutions of higher education. The other piece of the puzzle is what do the outcomes look like of those kids, right? So a place like Stanford can't really have a lot of kids moving from the bottom to the top because there aren't that many kids who start out at the bottom to begin with. So the question is, what do outcomes look like at other places that have a lot of low-income kids, and how do you put those two pieces together to sort of think about what these colleges are contributing to social mobility? And so turning to that piece of it, so I'm, again, just as a reference, going to start with Stanford. So this line now shows you the outcomes of children who went to Stanford, measuring their incomes when they're around 30 years old. And what we're asking is what fraction of the kids who went to Stanford themselves ended up in the top income quintile. And at Stanford, that's a very high rate. It's one of the highest rates of all colleges in America. Perhaps not surprisingly, you see really great outcomes. In this case, something like 65% of kids have reached the top income quintile in their mid-30s. Now, an interesting feature of that that pattern that you see there, which is true not just at Stanford, but at many other colleges in America, is that that line is almost flat. So why is that important? It tells you that kids who came from low-income families and middle-income families ended up at Stanford do just about as well as kids who come from high-income families. That, I think, is, again, a very encouraging result, as I've talked with the president of Stanford, president of Harvard, and many others. people find this fact extremely encouraging for trying to expand access because it shows you that the low-income kids who are getting in, you know, you might have worried that they struggle and don't end up doing well, and maybe it's really not a good match, but in fact, the low-income kids you do admit end up doing perfectly well, not just in terms of earnings, but a variety of other outcomes we've looked at, like patent rates, the types of occupations they're pursuing. You actually see quite a bit of comparability, which is encouraging for potentially trying to expand access at these places for kids for lower income families. So that's at Stanford. Now, this is UC San Diego, just for comparison. So UC San Diego, you see outcomes that are quite similar to Stanford, actually. But as we talked about earlier, more access for low-income kids. And so putting those two things together, you can think about how these two pieces of the puzzle lead to differences in mobility. And so to show you that, I'm going to focus on two statistics in particular. I'm going to focus on what I'll call access, the percentage of kids with parents in the bottom income quintile, so basically what is the height of that bar on the left, and then what I'll call the success rate, what fraction of kids who start out in low-income families at that college end up reaching the top income quintile. And what we can do is put those two data points together to construct what we call a college's mobility rate, which is the fraction of students who start out in a family in the bottom quintile and end up reaching the top quintile themselves. So to think about this number, suppose you've got 100 students at, let's say, a place like National University, which unfortunately is actually not in these data because of the relatively older student body. But I think similar data could be constructed for a place like National. So let's say you've got 100 students, and basically count the number that started out in a low-income family and ended up being relatively high income in the top quintile, okay? And so the mobility rate is just access times the success rate, okay? So to give you an example, at UC San Diego, about 9% of kids came from low-income families. Among those 9% of kids, 55% of those children reached the top income quintile. So multiplying those two things together, about 4.8% of children at UC San Diego started out in a low-income family and ended up at a high-income level themselves. So UC San Diego's mobility rate is 4.8% by this calculation, okay? So let's now see, following that logic, what are the top colleges in America in terms of channeling kids from the bottom to the top? And so what do you see at the top of this list? It's Cal State Los Angeles. So at Cal State Los Angeles, a remarkable 1 in 10 kids starts out in a low-income family and ends up in the upper middle class. And then you see a variety of other places. Pace University is a private university in New York, State University of New York, Stony Brook, the CUNY system, Glendale Community College in LA, and so forth. So there are lots of different colleges here. How would I generally characterize this list? They're what I would say are sort of mid-tier public institutions, places that combine a lot of access for low-income kids with quite good outcomes. That's how you end up channeling a lot of kids from the bottom to the top. You look at Ivy Plus colleges, places like Stanford that people pay a lot of attention to, and I think rightly so in terms of their excellent outcomes, but they are very low in terms of mobility rates, and that's because they just have very few low-income kids to begin with, so they can't possibly be contributing that much to social mobility because you don't have the input to kind of do that. And so that's why I think it's the mid-tier public institutions that really deserve a lot of focus. Now, you might be wondering, okay, so that we don't see a lot of San Diego area colleges on this list. So what we did is just pulled the data for San Diego area colleges and look at these statistics. And you can see I mentioned before UC San Diego at 4.8%, but then in general in San Diego, you actually don't see particularly high mobility rates for the institutions here. So that's just a fact in the data. And so I think that's something to think more about, and what is the role that places like National might be playing in addressing this problem, and how can these other institutions potentially do more to increase mobility, either on the access margin or on the margin of improving outcomes. So I want to show one final piece of data on colleges, which is to think about how these things have changed over time, which I think is very important from a policy perspective. So as you all know, private institutions in the US have been concerned about the lack of access and have made a number of efforts to try to increase access for low-income kids. So in particular, places like Stanford and Harvard and so forth in the mid-2000s went to a policy of essentially reducing tuition to close to zero for kids from low and middle-income families. But what you can see when you look at the fraction of low-income kids based on the year in which they got to college at Stanford is that that has essentially not changed, actually, over the past 12 years or so, past 12, 15 years. In contrast, if you look at state institutions, so here looking at UC San Diego and UC Riverside, we find that at many state universities, you see a pattern like what you see here in UC Riverside, where in the past, they had significantly larger numbers of low-income kids than they do today. So this, given the scaling, might not look like a big trend. If you look at the numbers, you're starting out at 15% of kids from low-income families at UC Riverside in 2000, gets down to 10% by the end of the period we're looking at, by 2011. So that is a one-third decline in the fraction of low-income kids, which means the amount you're contributing to economic mobility has fallen by one-third. So that's like quite substantial. Interestingly, I've noticed this, looking at the data for San Diego, UCSD is relatively flat in terms of access, unlike a number of the other UCs where you see, like Berkeley and Riverside, where you see declining access. And that's a pattern that's echoed at other colleges as well. So Glendale Community College in LA, substantial declining fraction of the number of low-income kids. But if you look at San Diego area community colleges, it's actually relatively flat. So that's encouraging. But nevertheless, you have to note that the levels of access at these San Diego colleges is not particularly high to begin with. So that's a concern to keep in mind. OK, so I've showed you a bunch of different data broadly on economic opportunity, on neighborhoods, focusing on higher education. Let me wrap up by talking about some broader lessons on how we can increase economic opportunity and what I think we should be thinking about in the path forward. So as I've noted here, I think focusing first on the higher education piece, San Diego currently has relatively few colleges that provide substantial access with strong long-term outcomes. And so one of the things I think that's extremely important to think about is how you can improve access to high-quality higher education. I'd be very interested seeing the data for places like National that cater to a non-traditional age student body as potentially an important piece of that puzzle. And so I think thinking about that issue is particularly important. With apologies for Laura for using the same name as you do for your CLIME initiative, we also have a CLIME initiative. In this case, the C is Collegiate Leaders in Increasing Mobility. And what we're doing there is we've partnered with 150 colleges around America to link their student record data to the data we work with in the federal government, which allows us to see students' outcomes after graduation and look at their parents' characteristics and so forth, really get that complete picture of how kids are doing from childhood to adulthood and the role that specific colleges play. And using that data, our goal going forward in this space is to understand exactly what programs are making some colleges more effective in terms of upward mobility and how institutions like UC San Diego might be able to identify more qualified kids from low-income families who are not currently applying or not currently being admitted. So that's a data-driven way to get at this problem, and we'd be interested if there are people here participating in that as one aspect to tackling this issue. Separately, as I said, higher education, I think, is one piece of the puzzle. It's not the only piece of the puzzle. And so thinking more broadly about the opportunity pipeline, I think factors like growing segregation and inequality may limit opportunities for upward mobility in San Diego going forward. And so again, on the data front, to try to approach this from an empirical point of view, what we're doing there is in May, we will release this fine-grained neighborhood level data, census tract by census tract, for the entire country, including all of San Diego. And using that, our vision is that we can design targeted interventions to improve the opportunity pipeline, where you will be able to zoom in and say, for Hispanic kids growing up in this part of San Diego, we see particularly poor outcomes. Let's go figure out why that is, at what ages things are going wrong, what kinds of interventions we might be able to implement to help kids do better there. And so we'd be excited to partner those of you who are working in that space on that dimension. So I want to end by talking about these issues from a different perspective, which you mentioned in the introduction, this issue of lost Einsteins, which to me gives a totally different way to think about issues of equality of opportunity and why I think all of us should be very concerned about this particular issue. So the traditional argument for equality of opportunity, as you all know, is based on principles of justice, the idea that everyone should have a shot at the American dream, no matter what their background is. But the last piece of data that I want to show you is that improving opportunities for upward mobility can also be useful just for increasing the size of the economic pie. Even if you're not concerned about inequality and fairness and opportunity in its own sake, but you just want to maximize GDP growth, maximize the vibrancy of the San Diego economy, you might still have an interest in equality of opportunity. And to illustrate that, I'm going to focus on one sector that I think of as being particularly relevant here in San Diego, which is innovation. So what we're going to do here is study the lives of 750,000 patent holders in America using patents as a proxy for innovation. And we link that patent data to the other data sets I've been describing so we can track the lives of inventors from birth to adulthood and basically ask where do the inventors in America come from and how can we get more of them. So I'll start by showing you this chart here, which shows you your probability of becoming an inventor versus your parents' income. And what you can see is each dot here represents one percentile of the parent income distribution. We're basically asking what fraction of kids in each of these 100 bins goes on to become an inventor by their mid-30s. You can see there's an incredibly strong relationship here. If you're born to parents below the median of the income distribution, about a 1 in 1,000 kids in that group becomes an inventor. If you happen to be born to parents in the top 1% of the income distribution, you're 10 times as likely to become an inventor. So there are two ways you might think about what might be going on here. So one possibility for why we see such a strong relationship between innovation rates and parental income is that this is about economic opportunity and the quality of schools and neighborhoods and the kinds of issues I've been emphasizing in this talk. A different perspective, which I think is a perfectly reasonable one to at least try to study, is that this is about differences in ability, perhaps. So maybe the kids of parents in the top 1%, you know, those parents must have had to be pretty talented to get to the top 1% themselves. And since, you know, there's genetic transmission, maybe that's why the kids themselves are more likely to become inventors. Show you how we can get it, separate those two explanations in the data. This chart here now brings in information on test scores as a proxy for kids' ability at a relatively early age. And so what this chart is showing you is the same vertical axis, patent rates, but now versus your third grade math test score. And each dot here represents 5% of the test score distribution. So the first thing you can see here is there's a very strong relationship between your probability of having a patent and your third grade math test scores. If you're below, say, the 90th percentile of your third grade math class, you're much less likely to have a patent than if you're at the top of your third grade math class, which shows you, by the way, that these early childhood test score indicators, while we all have lots of concerns about standardized tests, I think rightly so, there is actually information in these tests that's worth paying attention to. So that's fine, but what's I think of more interest here is the following cut of this data. Let's replicate that chart, but now split the kids into two groups based on their parents' income. So the orange chart is the same thing as before, the orange series, but for kids who grew up in relatively high income families, families that were above the 80th percentile in the top quintile. And the blue is everyone else, kids who grew up in low and middle income families. And what you see is a striking pattern, which is that high scoring children are much more likely to become inventors if they're from high income families. If you're from a low income family and you're at the top of your third grade math class, you're not all that much more likely to become an inventor than other kids, right? And so to put it differently, what these data seem to suggest is that in America, you really need two things to become an inventor. You need to be smart, as measured by, say, early childhood test scores, and you need to be from a rich family. And so you can see from that perspective why improving equality of opportunity can actually be quite valuable not just from a justice point of view, but because we get more innovators than the next person who discovers the important drug or starts a company like Qualcomm, et cetera, that, that ends up having a lot of influence in an area. And so just how big are the potential gains here? We estimate using these data that if women, minorities, and children from low-income families were to invent at the same rate as high-income white men, we would have four times as many inventors in America as we do today. And given that many people think of innovation as really the key driver of economic growth, this shows that there's a tight link between issues of inequality and opportunity and economic growth. It's not, you know, traditionally the narrative is there's a trade-off between inequality and economic growth. From this perspective, those two things might actually go together. As you have less inequality of opportunity, you also have more economic growth. And so let me end by coming back to the statistics that I started out with of kids' chances of climbing the income ladder. So I think one way you can look at these statistics is from a pessimistic sort of point of view that in the US as a whole, you only have a 7.5% chance of achieving the American dream of climbing the income ladder. And, you know, isn't that too bad? The American dream is fading. You know, we should all be quite concerned about this. And while I think there's some truth in that view, I actually look at this body of research and this body of data from a more optimistic perspective as presenting an opportunity and a challenge. I think the opportunity is illustrated by the fact that there are places like Silicon Valley or Dubuque, Iowa, where a remarkable 17 or 18% of kids climb from the bottom fifth to the top fifth. There are such places in the US today which provide good opportunities for low-income kids, showing that it is possible to have opportunity throughout America. I think the challenge is for us as scientists and academics to figure out exactly what we need to do to expand opportunity throughout the United States. And the challenge for all of you as practitioners is to figure out how you might be able to implement those solutions in places like San Diego to restore the American dream. Thanks so much.